And my own attitudes towards war, I guess, came out of, well, two things. Came out of, well, my study of history and my own experience in war. And I was in the Air Force in World War II, and I dropped bombs on various cities in Europe, on Germany and Czechoslovakia and Hungary and France. I enlisted to, you know, because this was the good war. This is the war against fascism. And it's true, you can make out a better case for World War II, although now I don't believe there's such a thing as a good war or just war. But you can make out a better case for World War II than any other because, yeah, there is this terrible evil fascism and we must do something about it. And people didn't think, well, is this the only way to do something about it? Is killing 600,000 ordinary people in Germany through our bombing, killing 100,000 people in one night in Dresden, is killing several hundred thousand people in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, is incarcerating 120,000 Japanese in our country, is engaging in a war that will kill 50 or 60 million people, is this the only possible way to resist fascism? Or is it that after something has happened, and this is an interesting phenomenon, after something has happened a certain way in history, it's very hard to imagine it happening any other way. Very hard to imagine another scenario. The thing that has happened, if it's happened in a certain way, it has a certain look of inevitability, of this is the only way. But if we are human beings with ingenuity and imagination, we have to begin thinking of different ways of solving problems. Because war, and this is the conclusion I came to only after the war, because during the war I was an eager bombardier. During the war, I dropped bombs on people, didn't think about it. I didn't see people, you know, dropping bombs from 30,000 feet, and, you know, didn't see people, didn't see human beings dying, children, their limbs turned off, didn't see that. And so much of modern war has that aspect, you know. So much of modern war is killing people at a distance. The pilots come back from Iraq and happily say, a mission accomplished. You know, did they know who they killed? With even the most sophisticated of bombing devices, do they really know who they killed? They don't. No way. No, war, the technology of war has reached the point, certainly ever since World War I, where war is indiscriminate killing of innocent people, and to a large extent, children. And when war has become that, when war has become the indiscriminate killing of innocent people, then you mustn't engage in it, no matter what you're told, no matter what you're told about democracy and terrorism and this and that. No, because in your reaction to this, in your support of this, you will be supporting an atrocity. You will be supporting terrorism. War is terrorism. This is an important thing to keep in mind when you think we're fighting against terrorists. War is terrorism. I see Bush as a terrorist. Seriously. Seriously. Terrorism is the willingness to kill large numbers of people for some presumably good cause. That's what terrorists are about. And governments, and this is a troubling thought, governments are capable of far larger scale terrorism than bands of terrorists like Al-Qaeda or the IRA or, you know, who, PLO. I mean, those terrorists can do terrible things, but governments can do much more terrible things. We need to think about war as something that cannot be acceptable anymore. For any reason. That's a conclusion I came to after the war, and after I looked at Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and after I looked at missions that I'd been on, I had no idea what I was doing. And I began to think about certain things, certain ideas and certain principles, I began to think about how is it that people get inveigled into war. I've recently came across this thing by, I always claim I have something that I'm going to show you, you know. I'll paraphrase it. You know, we who are great scholars, we love exact quotations, which doesn't mean much because they can be taken out of context. But I'll paraphrase it. After World War II, Hermann Göring, you remember Hermann Göring? Good guy. Hitler's second in command. He and other Nazi leaders were in prison in Germany awaiting trial in the Nuremberg war crimes trial. And the Allies hired a psychologist to talk to these, I guess he's trying to figure out, what motivated them? Peer into their minds, what made them do these things? Never think of hiring a psychologist to look into your own mind, but look into their minds. And so the psychologist interviewed Göring, took notes, wrote a book about his interviews. And one of the things he asked Göring is, how are the German people led into this war, which was so disastrous for them? And Göring said, it's simple, really. It's not a problem. He said, people don't really want to go to war. But you tell them that some terrible thing will happen to them if they don't go to war. You tell them that you're fighting against some evil. And, just tell it to them enough times, and they'll believe it, and you'll go to war. One of the things that happen in war, and this is what I began to think about as I thought about my own trajectory from being a warrior, being a bombardier, to being anti-war, I realized that what happens is that if the other side is evil, which it often is, you assume then that your side must be good. May not be so. The other side may be evil, and you might also be evil. Now, maybe they're a little more evil. But the point is that you're not suddenly blessed with purity because you are fighting against something evil. It may be that the people on your side are really not great. When you think about it, who fought against Hitler? The British Empire, the French Empire, Stalin's Russia, the American Empire. Really, when you look at it that way, I know I'm calling names empires, but that's what they were. So you go through this psychological trick. They're bad, therefore we're good, forgetting that war corrupts everybody.